Welcome back to your free Windows 7 training. In the last video, we looked at the basic configuration options for the Windows Firewall. The basic configuration works well until you need to do something more advanced. To perform more advanced configuration, you will need to use the Windows Firewall with Advanced Security tool. In previous versions of Windows, such as Windows Vista and Windows XP, you could configure port exemption using the basic firewall tool. In Windows 7, this has been removed from the basic tool. To configure port exemptions, you now need to use the advanced tool. In most cases, you can get around this by creating exceptions based on software. Creating a software exemption through the firewall gives you the added bonus that you do not have to know the port or ports that the program is using. Using Windows Firewall with Advanced Security also gives you more granular control over the rules that are used. For example, you can allow only data that comes from a certain IP address. Windows Firewall with Advanced Security also gives you control over the incoming rules used in the firewall. Once you have configured the firewall the way you want it, you may use the settings on another computer. With the advanced tool, you can export the firewall settings so they can be imported on another computer. These settings can also be imported into group policy. This means you can configure one computer the way you want it and then deploy these settings to all computers on your network using group policy. Let's have a look at how to configure the Windows Firewall with Advanced Security. To access the Advanced tool, first I will open the Basic tool from the Control Panel by opening System and Security and then opening the Firewall. From here, all I need to do is select the option Advanced Security from the left-hand side. First of all, I will open the Properties for Windows Firewall with Advanced Security. From here, you can set the default behavior for inbound and outbound connections. By default, the firewall will block incoming connections unless a rule is created to allow the traffic in. If you are connected to an unsecure network, such as a wireless hotspot at an airport, you may want to select the option Block All Connections. By default, outbound connections will be allowed. However, you can change this to Block. Doing this on most computers would be pointless, as it would stop your computer from accessing the network, but in some cases, you may want to do this. These options apply to the domain profile. If you want to change the settings for other locations, it is just a matter of selecting the tab Domain, Private, or Public from the top. The last tab is IPSec settings. If you select the Customize button, you can configure how IPSec will operate. It is beyond the scope of this course to go into too much detail about the IPSec options, and in most cases the default options work fine. If you have a non-Microsoft IPSec device on your network, you may need to configure some option in here to make it work correctly. You may be wondering what IPSec has to do with the Windows Firewall. With Windows 7, IPSec has been integrated in the firewall, which makes it a lot easier to configure. To understand why, consider this network. The problem occurs when you want to use IPSec to encrypt network traffic. Look what happens when you open the ports for IPSec in the firewall. Any data traveling over the IPSec connection bypasses the Windows Firewall. That means any malware on the other side of the IPSec connection can use the IPSec connection to infect your computer. To fix this problem, IPSec and other connections to your computer can be configured inside the Windows Firewall interface. This means any traffic traveling over an IPSec connection is subject to the same firewall rules as any other network data. This means any malware attempting to travel over an IPSec connection will hopefully be stopped by your firewall. If I now go back to the Windows Firewall with Advanced Security, the last option in IPSec you may want to configure is Exempt ICMP from IPSec. Allowing ICMP traffic allows troubleshooting tools such as ping to work, which can make troubleshooting IPSec problems a lot easier. The next area I want to look at are the inbound rules. Any rules that are enabled will be in green, and any that are disabled will be gray. If I select the rules for file and printer sharing, you will notice that there are a lot of them. In the basic Windows Firewall control panel, you only have one option to enable file and printer sharing. Using the Windows Firewall with advanced security gives you a lot more granular control over what you want to enable through the firewall. For example, when you enable file sharing on your computer, you also enable echo requests, which means the computer will respond to ping requests. If you just want file and printer sharing and don't want pings responded to, you can select all the other rules and enable them. Notice that there are four rules for echo request. Looking closer, there are in fact only two rules. One rule for IP version 4 and the other for IP version 6. The rules are duplicated because one has been created for each profile, in this case, the domain and private profiles. The same applies if I wanted to enable file sharing, but not enable printer sharing. You would simply enable the file sharing rules and leave the printer spooler rules disabled like this. You will also notice a section for outbound rules. The Windows 7 firewall has bi-directional support, so you can create rules to either allow or disallow incoming traffic. If I right-click on Inbound Rules, I can select the option New Rule. On the first screen of the New Rule wizard, I can select which type of rule I want to create. By default, I can select Program Rule. When selecting Program Rule, any traffic generated from that program will automatically be allowed through the firewall. The next option is Port Rule. For example, if you wanted to allow all web traffic through, you could select Port Rule for Port 80. This means any software using Port 80 will be allowed through the firewall. The advantage of a port rule is that if malware attached itself to the software, it would only be able to use Port 80. With a software rule, malware can open any port that it wants, since the Windows firewall will consider the software trusted. If you are not sure what port you are trying to enable, or multiple ports are required, you can try the pre-defended area for a lot of the commonly used services. For example, if I want to enable traffic for iSCSI, I could select it here. In this case, I will select the option Custom, as it gives me the most options. On this screen, you can select the program you want the rule to apply to. For example, if I wanted to stop the user from browsing the internet, I could select the Internet Explorer executable. The problem with this approach is the user could install another browser, such as Firefox, and bypass this rule. For this example, I will leave it on All Programs and move on. On the next screen, you can select the protocol the rule will apply to. In this case, I will select TCP, which means the rule will apply to all traffic, regardless of whether it is IP version 4 or IP version 6. The next option allows you to select the local port. Selecting a local port is useful if you want to allow a service through or block it from coming in. In this case, I want to stop the user from accessing port 80 on another computer, so I need to set this in the remote port section. On the screen, I can set the local and destination IP addresses that this port will apply to. In this case, if I wanted to make sure that the users only access the internet by going through my proxy server, I would put the destination IP address in here. The next screen determines if the rule is an allow rule or a block rule. Notice also the option allow the connection if it is secure. This means traffic will only be allowed if it comes over an IPSec connection. In this example, I will block traffic, so I will leave it on the default of block. The next screen will determine which profile this rule will apply to. In this case, I will configure this rule to only apply to the public network. This means if the user tries to connect to my local internet web server or the internet via my proxy server when connected to an internal network, they will be allowed. Lastly, I can set a name for the rule and press Finish. You can also create connection security rules. To do this, all I need to do is right-click on Connection Security Rules to start the wizard. The first option in the wizard creates an isolation rule. An isolation rule essentially creates a rule based on whether the computer meets a certain criteria. For example, if the computer is a member of a domain. The name isolation rule is a little confusing, but what it's supposed to mean is that if the computer does not meet the criteria, then it will be isolated. In the real world, this is not really the case. It simply means that the computer will not be able to communicate over that connection, but will still be able to communicate over any other network the firewall allows it to. The next option allows you to create a connection that will not require authentication. This does not mean that it is not encrypted. It just means no authentication is required to bring up the connection. Usually when creating these connections, the IP address of both parties is checked to ensure the connection is coming from where it is supposed to. However, IP addresses can be faked, so this type of security is considered weak. The server-to-server option allows you to specify the IP address on both ends of the connection. This could be, as the name suggests, servers, but also could be subnets or groups of computers. The option Tunnel is used when you want IPSec to use tunnel mode instead of transport mode. This essentially means that all IP packets are encoded and placed in the tunnel and must be decoded on the other side. With transport mode, the packet may be decoded by many different endpoints. However, with tunnel mode, the packets can only exit from one point. In this case, I will select Custom so you can see more options. On this screen, you can enter in the endpoint or endpoints that you want to use. In other words, where the traffic can come from and where it can go. On the next screen, you can determine when authentication will be used, if at all. You even have the option of requesting it and using clear communication if it is not available. In this case, I will select Require Authentication for inbound connections, but only request it for outbound connections. This means that any traffic coming into the computer will be encrypted, but going out will only be encrypted if the other computer supports it. On the next screen, you can configure which type of authentication you will use. By default, Kerberos will be used. However, if you want to use other methods, you can select Advanced. For example, if you needed to connect to third-party network devices. The next screen allows you to see the protocol and type. In this case, I will select TCP and port 23. Port 23 is the Telnet port, which is not encrypted, so this rule will attempt to encrypt Telnet data using IPSec when possible. Lastly, I can select the profile, which I will leave on the default, and finally enter a name for the rule. Now that the rule is created, you may want to export the settings. To do this, right-click Windows Firewall with Advanced Security and select the option Export Policy. Once exported, these settings can be imported into another computer. Group Policy uses the same interface, so you can also import the settings into Group Policy and apply them to your domain. That's it for Windows Firewall. In the next video, I will look at how you can configure remote management to support your Windows 7 computers. If you are after more videos, exam questions, and study guides, have a look at our website. Thanks for watching.